live stream for those of you who are tuning into the live stream. Today, I will be talking about what's eventually going to be my dissertation project. I'm going to be talking about three of the solos out of 12. This presentation is called Filling the Void, a presentation on three new solos for the student Euphoniumist. And again, I will be presenting three of my own original works for student-level euphonium players. Those three works are... Those three works are Victory and Defeat, which is a middle school level solo with piano accompaniment. Insects 1, yes, there will be a second one. That's the intermediate high school level solo with piano accompaniment. And Act Natural, which will be an advanced high school level solo without piano accompaniment, so unaccompanied. These three works will be part of a collection of 12 new compositions that will serve as my dissertation project, and the collection will contain the following altogether. Four works for middle school level, all with piano accompaniment, four works for intermediate high school, with one of them being unaccompanied, and four works for advanced high school level, three of them with piano, again, one unaccompanied. All 12 pieces will be suitable for solo and ensemble, possible all-state lists and recitals, and will be recorded by myself on piano and myself on euphonium and James Lee on piano, who you'll see in a bit. It's important to note that the three solos being presented today will not necessarily be in the order they'll appear in the overall collection. They'll be a little more spread out. So I decided on this topic for my recital and for the project based on my own personal experience as a middle and high school student who struggled to find original compositions at the student level that were engaging to practice and perform and that had enough substance to take to competition. Except for a few standard works, many student euphonium solos are transcriptions taken from the repertoire of other instruments. So with my extensive performance and composition experience, I decided I wanted to do my best to add some new, engaging literature to the repertoire that introduces students to various musical techniques, styles, and challenges they would not often run into elsewhere. After talking with a few colleagues and other studios here at UMKC, the same problem seems to be present for other instruments as well, where there's not really enough good student solos for those instruments. So yeah, I want to maybe turn this into a large-scale project for other instruments as well after I do this euphonium version. So with the methodology, let me get here. While composing each of the 12 pieces, I'm using the International Tuba and Euphonium Association's difficulty rating system to determine certain boundaries and limits as to how I write each piece so that each is sustainable or suitable yet challenging for its respective level. The four works for middle school level will be labeled with a single blue star under the title, and the intermediate high school works will have two stars, and the advanced high school works will have three stars. This immediately informs the student of the solo's difficulty. The ITEA rating system covers four main areas, each with subcategories. The more subcategories that the piece includes, the more points are added to the total score. The higher the overall point amount, the more difficult the piece. So let's go ahead and take a look at the four main areas. The first one that you can see on the picture there is range. For range, we have four subcategories. We have basic range, which is B-flat 2 to B4. We have high range, which is E-flat 4 all the way up to E-flat 5 and above. We have low range A, which is A2 down to E2, and low range B, which is E-flat 2 down to B-flat 1 or below. So the next one I want to talk about is the second category. That would be dexterity. This category focuses on intervallic dexterity and overall technical and finger dexterity. It is measured by selecting the most difficult or influential interval and determining if the piece falls under easy, medium, or difficult dexterity. It is worth noting that each category in the ITEA rating system has a max overall rhythmic and temporal difficulty. It is measured by selecting two rhythms that characterize the piece and determine if the piece's tempo falls under slow, medium, or fast. Again, you can see the diagram there. While it's a little bit small, we have some rhythmic values listed there, along with the points that are associated with them, and then the tempo, slow, medium, and fast. And lastly, the final category is miscellaneous. This category covers all other musical elements that add difficulty to a work. These elements include key changes, time changes, difficult keys, use of mutes, clef changes, ornamentation, and more. It is measured by selecting all of the applicable techniques from the provided list and adding the points together. And as you can see, I know again it's a little small, about all the different things from Sherrill's ornamentations, multiple tempo changes, chromaticism, all that jazz. All right. So, give me one second. Change that little bit over. There we go. So, ITEA also considers the pianist and piano part when determining the work's difficulty. Too often in student solos, the piano part essentially consists of the right hand doubling the solo line, often an octave or two higher, and the left hand will play both broken chords or arpeggios or just block chords. When this writing style is used excessively, I do not believe it helps in creating a rewarding experience for the soloist and pianist. So in addition to the goal of having my collection of solos be engaging for the soloist, I'm striving to make it a point to write effective and idiomatic piano parts as well. And there is their little blurb on piano parts about easy, medium, and difficult, and the factors that make them fall under each one. All right. So as part of my research, I have also been studying some of the already existing standard euphonium solos. Those include J.E. Barat's Introduction and Dance, which is is a great intermediate high school solo that includes challenges for the soloist, such as fast lip slurs and 16th note triplets. I've been studying James Curnow's Rhapsody for Euphonium. All you euphonium players out there have probably played this or know of it. It's one of the go-to advanced high school solos, and it's idiomatically written for the instrument and presents challenges, including playing in the high register, double tonguing, and those dreaded extended 16th note chromatic runs. I've also been studying Fred Clenard's Sonata for Unaccompanied Euphonium for inspiration for my unaccompanied pieces in this collection. This work is a fantastic example of an effective unaccompanied solo suitable for high school students, and the work calls for a great deal of musicality and interpretation and contains challenging yet doable technical demands. All right, so now that we have a good idea of how I'm approaching the compositions and the research behind them, let's dive into the analysis of the actual three works I'm presenting today. The first one's called Victory and Defeat. I was originally going to name it Defeat and Victory, but I wanted to go against the norm and make it, instead of a story where the protagonist overcomes hardship and eventually emerges triumphant, they instead think they're going to be triumphant, and then they are not. So that's sort of akin to a Greek tragedy. So I musically have portrayed this story through a confident, victorious A section and a contrasting, somber, defeated B section. And then here you can see the difficulty rating that I have here. This is again, goes along with the ITEA rating system. The main goals of Victory and Defeat are to promote a full sound and forward-moving air, to gain experience with contrasting articulations, dynamics, time signatures, in this case 4-4 versus 3-4, musical styles and modes, key centers, and to be able to perform an independent solo part with piano accompaniment. The piece is at a suitable length for middle school level, at approximately 2 to 3 minute consulting with various state solo and ensemble guidelines and already existing works, this seems to be about the average length of time for middle school solos. So, victory and defeat is in binary form, with the contrasting aforementioned A and B sections. The piece opens with the soloist playing an unaccompanied arpeggiated B-flat 7 chord at a forte dynamic. These loud, sustained arpeggiated figures appear throughout the A section, promoting the need for full inhalations and playing with a full, energized sound. And here you can see the opening of the work. So you've got the B-flat 7 chord and the piano part sort of answering to it. The A section is louder and consists of many accented notes, while the B section is much more lyrical and quiet, with almost everything slurred in the solo part. This contrast will get the soloist used to playing with different articulations, dynamics, and styles. While the end of the A section would sound more climactic, one octave up in the solo part, not all middle school students would be able to play the high Fs and E flats required if that were the case. So I've notated an optional 8BA for octave up marking in the solo line. And I have it sort of circled there with the red circle, is the 8BA right there. And then there's the lyrical B section right next to it. Alright. So the A section switches between B flat mixolydian mode, which is in this case inclusion of the lowered seventh, A flat. And the key of B-flat major, exclusion of the A-flat, replaced with an A-natural. And the B-section is in G minor, the relative minor key to B-flat major. This gives the soloist experience playing in different modes that actually all consist of the same key signature. The B-section, marked at quarter note equals 90, is slightly slower than the A-section, which is quarter note equals 110. This somewhat subtle tempo change will give the soloist experience with more nuanced tempo changes. And now that I've discussed the analysis and method behind victory and defeat, let's hear what the piece sounds like in its entirety. I hope you enjoy victory and defeat for euphonium and piano, and please welcome James Lee to the stage. Thank you. like the buzzing wings of the bee, and the loud sforzando cluster chords in the piano part represent those pesky wasps getting in the way. I imagine the lyrical B section representing the bee flying through a beautiful mountain range at sunset. The main goals of Insects 1 are to give the soloist experience performing a variety of articulations, dynamics, styles, rhythms, and tonal key centers all within one piece. Some other goals of this work include having the soloist play in a slightly expanded range. Here we have low Fs and high Gs, giving the soloist experience with awkward fourth vowel or first and third, or first, second, and third fingerings at fast tempos, encouraging confident and in-time finger dexterity, and giving the student experience playing grace notes and trills, otherwise known as ornamentation. Insects 1 is in a truncated ternary form, with a fast A section, a contrasting slower B section, and a brief restatement of the A material. The A section is at a brisk quarter note equals, I believe it's changed to 140, but it used to be 132, and there's a tempo marking of scurry. I originally had buzzing as the tempo marking, but I soon realized students might actually mistake that with an instruction to buzz on the mouthpiece. Which would be an unfortunate misunderstanding. The A section is full of various articulation markings with a focus on staccato articulations, and those various articulations occur throughout several dynamic changes. This promotes the student keeping the staccato articulation consistently light and buoyant regardless of the dynamic. The A section flows through a variety of tonal centers, yet always returns to C major. The lyrical B section begins in C minor, the parallel minor of C major, and like the A section, explores several temporary tonal centers. However, for the most part, the B section revolves around E flat major. The A section goes straight into the B section via retardando in a 2-beat long ascending chromatic run of 16th notes in the left hand of the piano, which you can see in the diagram written below the text there. This all gives the student soloist experience smoothly transitioning into contrasting section and tempo, rather than there being a fermata or caesura and then a reset in the new section, which is often the case in the student solos. So my undergraduate professor, Dr. Kenneth Cresci, heavily emphasized having me use imagery when playing music. This method helped me tremendously in giving character to the music and altering how it sounded in a positive way. Because of this, I always encourage my own students to use imagery when playing music, especially if I sense they're having trouble grasping the character, mood, or atmosphere of the piece. While I provided my own imagery for Insects 1 for the purpose of the recital, I plan on intentionally leaving out the detailed imagery descriptors in the program notes for this piece in the final collection, only providing the title Insects 1 in an effort to encourage the student soloist to envision their own story to the piece. Now that we know the story and the structure of Insects 1, let us hear the work in its entirety.
Thank you.
two different scenarios where it is difficult to act natural. The first scenario is a classic, someone asking their crush to the school dance. Dreamy, sometimes unfocused, and sweeping melodic lines represent this exciting and nerve-wracking experience. And the second section is completely opposite, conveys a thief trying to act natural and blend in with the crowd after pulling off a heist. On certain fragmented motives and a creeping arpeggiated figure, eighth-note figure begin the faster segment before launching into a confident grooving section. The thief thinks they are safe. However, the creeping eighth-note figure reappears and traverses throughout a few different key centers as the thief gets closer and closer to getting caught. The piece ends with the thief successfully escaping in a helicopter, represented by the running 16th notes in the solo euphonium line at the end. The main goals of Act Natural are to give the student experience playing unaccompanied solos, playing in difficult keys. In this case, the B section is mostly in G flat major, ironic, giving the title of the piece. I want to give the student experience playing in compound and irregular meters, 7, 8, and 8, 8. Reading contemporary notation, in this case feathered beamings and timed rests. Playing with rubato and using dynamic, rhythmic, and temporal interpretation. As you can see in the diagrams here, we have the timed rests, super small, those are second markings, so 1, 2, and 3 seconds. We have the irregular meter, which I notated the groupings of the eighth notes. We have 8-8 and 7-8, and then there's one instance of feathered beamings right before letter D, where it's quite tricky, where you have to start fast and slow down, but crescendo throughout, which is almost the opposite of what you naturally want to do. So that is a little tricky part. All right, so Act Natural is in binary form. Except for a few brief departures, the slower A section is centered around the key of F major. It also contains multiple meter changes and various types of articulations. Because the melodic material is somewhat repetitive, it's important that the solos create some musical variation with the melodies by counteracting the repetitiveness. I intentionally included a minimal amount of specific dynamic, temporal, expressive, and articulation markings, except for what I deemed necessary, so that there is a lot of room left for the soloist to determine their own interpretation of the piece. The B section is faster, quarter note equals around 124, and begins in G flat major, before modulating to D minor, and then finally ending in E flat major. The B section consists of two distinct motivic ideas, arpeggiating, sort of freely rhythmic, detached eighth notes, and a syncopated groove inspired by action movie soundtracks. As I mentioned earlier, there is an optional ABA octave up, notated for a few measures containing a low E flat and F flat, to accommodate students playing on non-compensating euphoniums and to provide an easier alternative overall. So that concludes the analysis of Act Natural. It is my hope that you found this lecture recital informative and interesting. I believe it is important that middle and high school students have just as much substantial repertoire to choose from that collegiate and professional players do also. I also believe composers need to consider certain musical limitations in their works for student-level musicians while simultaneously providing engaging and challenging pieces for the student to enjoy. Is definitely a fine line to walk on. Before I perform Act Natural in its entirety, I would like to thank Professor Tom Stein and Dr. Lee Harrelson for their constant support and mentorship. Working with them has been absolutely amazing, and I've loved every second I've been here at UNKC. I want to thank James Lee again for his willingness to help me with this massive project, all while he has his own DMA stuff that he's working on. And last but certainly not least, I'd like to thank my friends and family for coming out to the recital or tuning in to the live stream. It means the world to me that you're tuning in, and your constant support of my musical endeavors. I really couldn't do this without any of you. and possibly other student solo projects in the future. Without further ado, please enjoy Act Natural for Solo Euphonium.
After I take a drink of water.
So it was hard to fit four pieces of music on one slide.
Thank you.